Hi, this is Justin, and today I want to talk a little bit more about the seven basic plots and talk about rags to riches. So in the last video, I gave kind of an overview, a basic overview of all seven plots, and I talked about this idea partly from Booker and partly from David Brooks that all of these stories can kind of fit into a life cycle. This kind of goes back to my theory or my question about what story is for in general. What is it? What does it do for us? What does it do for us? What is it that compels us to tell stories to each other? I have a lot of thoughts about that, a lot of theories about that. So think of that. This is just one way to think of it. I'm not saying this is the exclusive way, but think of rags to riches here as the story of how someone goes from pure potential, pure Aristotelian potential, into some kind of form of competence, some kind of place where you can take on responsibility, some kind of place where you can accomplish things, and then that is what makes you worthy of having responsibilities, of being responsible for people underneath you. It makes you a worthy ruler. And you'll see with the examples that we're going to use today, some of them are ancient, some of them are new, but generally, the central question, or one of the central questions and themes in these stories, is what are the necessary qualities that a person needs to have in order to rule effectively, in order to be in charge effectively, right? And I really think that there's a sense that these stories are, you could say, designed for that purpose. The reason why we tell these stories to children, right? There's a lot of children's stories in the rags to riches world. Ugly Duckling, Aladdin, Popeye, Cinderella. Right, there's a lot of discussion going on in the world of our adolescent children with regard to the stories that we tell them that have to do with this is what you need to be effective in the world, right? So obviously this plot is very universal. This is one of the most monetized plots in the world. It's one of the oldest plots in the world. The story of Joseph is actually fits the rags to riches plot pretty well. David Copperfield, My Fair Lady, Sword in the Stone, Superman, Popeye, Rocky. Let me get rid of myself here so I can show you Aladdin. Today I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk a little bit about My Fair Lady, Aladdin, Cinderella, and then there's a great Coen Brothers movie called Hudsucker Proxy, and we'll look at some examples from that. So I'm going to show you a video from Kurt Vonnegut first. Kurt Vonnegut has a famous talk. If you don't know, he's one of the most successful and probably famous novelists of the last century, and American novelist. And he has this famous talk that he gives on the shape of stories. So this is a perfect kind of introduction to this plot type.
This is the GI axis, good fortune, ill fortune. Sickness and poverty down here, wealth and boisterous good health up there. Here's the very middle. Now, this is the BE axis. B stands for beginning. E stands for electricity. Now, this is an exercise in relativity, really, is the shape of the curves of what matters and not their origins. So we'll start a little above average is why get a depressing person? We'll start the whole thing. We call this story Man in Hole, but it needn't be about a man and it needn't be about somebody getting into a hole. But it's just a good way to remember it. Somebody gets into trouble, gets out of it again. People love that story. They never get sick of it. All right, not copyrighted. Another story, also a beautiful curve and easily fed into a computer, called Boy Gets Girl, but it needn't be that. Just a way to remember it. Start on an average day, average person, not expecting anything to happen, a day like any other. Find something wonderful, just loves it. Oh, God damn it. Got it back again. People like that. Now, these are beautiful curves, and this gets a little complicated. As computers can now play chess, so I don't know why they can't digest this very difficult curve I'm going to draw for you now. And it so happens that this is the most popular story in our civilization, Western civilization. As we love to hear this story, every time it's retold, somebody makes another $1 million. You're welcome to do it. Now, surprisingly enough, I've said it's depressing. You know, people don't like stories about below average days and people. But we're going to start way down here. Worse than that, who is so low? It's a little girl. What's happened? Her mother has died. Her father has remarried a vile-tempered, ugly woman with two nasty daughters, big daughters. You've heard it. See? Anyway, there's a party at the palace that night. She can't go. She has to help everybody else get ready. She has to stay home. Now, does she sink lower? No. She's a staunch little girl, and she has had the maximum whack from fate, which is the loss of her mother. She can't go any lower than that. Okay, so the fairy godmother comes. Gives her shoes, gives her stocking, gives her mascara. Gives her a means of transportation, goes to the party, dances with the prince, has a swell time. Boring, 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 boring. Now there's a slight inclination to that line as I've drawn it because it takes perhaps 20 seconds, 30 seconds for a grandfather clock to strike 12. Does she wind up at the same level? Of course not. She will remember that dance for the rest of her life. Now, she poops along on this level till the prince comes, the shoe fits. She achieves off-scale happiness.
Okay, so she achieves off-scale happiness. So that's the Cinderella story. That's the shape of the Cinderella story. Now, what's going to be interesting as we go along here is you're going to see that oftentimes these stories do have certain shapes. And so the mountain, the two mountains shape that we saw there with Kurt Vonnegut is definitely a helpful way to think about the rags to riches plot. Okay, so last time I introduced briefly Booker's five act stages, how he thinks about the moods of the different acts. You'll read books about five-act story structure, and you might find different wording here. I like Booker's explanation, Booker's labeling of these sections, because while there might be different functions within each act within the story, I find that these descriptions actually help you understand the mood of each stage. So if you want to revisit these, go back and watch the last video. But in general, your anticipation stage is this to set up what's about to come, give a little question, a little clue about what we're about to explore. The dream stage is usually some kind of initial success as the hero ventures out into the special world. But it's not real in a lot of sense. It's a fantasy world. It really, I think, represents the world that you step into where you think things are going to go well for you, but you haven't really encountered anyone that wants to do you harm yet. You step in to this other world, and you start to use your natural skills, and then somebody finds out about you. And then you enter the frustration stage where they say, hold on a second, You can't just come in here and take whatever you want. We have something to say here too. So you're going to find in all of the seven plot types, there's this shift from dreamlike quality, which is this false sense of success, or maybe it's what success would be like if there were no antagonists, right? And then as the antagonism starts to kick in, starts to engage, that leads to a frustration stage where it's like, oh, okay, well, this is going to be a little bit harder than I thought, right? And then the nightmare stage is when you enter into that place of total conflict. Oftentimes, the hero at the mercy of the villain scene is in the nightmare stage. And it's just this idea that you're under the full weight of the antagonist. Now, as we get to overcoming the monster, you'll get to see a real good example of this. And then you've got your conclusion. Okay, so that's a we're going to go through these, so don't worry. All right. So how does that look in rags to riches? Here's Aladdin and Cinderella, right? Now both Aladdin and Cinderella are diamonds in the rough, right? That's in the movie. Diamond in the rough. They have something that the community needs. And when we get to Hudsucker Proxy, you're going to see what that is. Usually, there is a stepmother or a stepfather that is exploiting them. I think the quintessential scene of that is that song in Les Mis, Master of the House, where it's you got the innkeeper that's exploiting little Cosette, right? They only care about themselves, and they usually have a massive blind spot. Their egoism, their short-term thinking, you might say, blinds them to something important. And oftentimes it is the hero, it is Cinderella, or it is Aladdin that has the key to that. Okay, so just keep that in the back of your mind. Now, then you get to the dream stage, right? That was the anticipation stage. Okay, they're overlooked and neglected, and there's some corrupt person at the top of the hierarchy that is ruling with corruption or with tyrannical authority that is not just. Okay, that's the state of the world that we find in the anticipation stage. And then this magic comes in. Some magic enters the story. Even in a story without a genie or without a fairy godmother, in modern stories, you'll see this. You'll see some representation of a genie-like figure, a fairy godmother-like figure that gives them magic. Like Kurt Vonnegut says, shoes, a dress, a coach, horses, everything that you need to get up to the top of society. In My Fair Lady, Henry Higgins comes in and starts to teach Eliza Doolittle proper English so that she can mingle with the rich and famous at the horse races, right? So after that comes in, and again, we're going to explore this a little bit more. They wind up at the top dancing, flying with royalty. I kind of really love that section, those scenes where they're basically at the top, but it's still the dream stage. Remember, this is before the antagonists come in and say, wait a minute, you can't have all that success, not if I have something to say about it, right? So she winds up dancing with the prince. Aladdin winds up flying around with the princess. Eliza Doolittle winds up conversing with all the high society types, and everything seems great, but it's a dream. It's not real yet, in some sense. Why? Well, it might be because they don't deserve it yet. They've been helped along by the fairy godmother, helped along by the genie. Aladdin is not a real prince. The genie is making him seem like a prince. So that's probably part of it. Now, then there's a fall. The magic runs out. The clock strikes midnight. All of that help is now pulled away. And they wind up now, because they've gotten the attention of the evil stepsisters or the wicked stepmother or whoever else, Jafar, who wants the throne, or whoever it else it is that's jealous of their success, they wind up now taking one on the chin. So it's like you step in there, and then now people are like, hold on a second, you can't have all that. And you fall all the way down. Now, the climb back up here, let me get rid of myself here for a second. The climb up, where you're basically now having to confront those illegitimate rulers or that illegitimate authority, Now is done in without the help of the fairy godmother, without the help of genie. And then something happens that causes them to come out on top again, usually having something to do with that piece that they have that is the part of the world that they see that the antagonists do not have. The antagonists, Jafar, the wicked stepmother, etc., have this blind spot, like I said. They don't see the world. They don't see the whole picture. They might see the world in too short term of a scenario, or they might be oblivious to the needs or the wants and desires of anyone else. But something, some kind of a blind spot that then is exploited. Okay, so that's the basic pattern. Okay, and then they once they wind up at the top, there's always a speech. There's always a song. There's always some kind of a scene that says, this hero is now worthy of being princess, worthy of being king or prince, worthy of being the head of the company, worthy of being in charge, right? So, really, again, you're helped along at first. You fall when you encounter these antagonists, and then you develop the character, you develop the skill, as well as the know-how. To be able to rule justly. And that includes compassion and ambition, right? So you might say that the stepmother and Jafar and these antagonists have that hard-edged real-world ambition that complements or counterpoints the naivete of this young hero. And they need to internalize a little bit of that competition. And that's what this fall is about. Okay, you got to toughen up a little bit, right? And then when you get up to the top, they've still retained the compassion, the concern for those below them in the hierarchy. That is the blind spot that these antagonists had. That's basically the argument that I'm going to try to make for you guys. And you can let me know whether or not I'm successful. Okay. So let's take a look a little bit closer look at these five acts here. Okay, so I'm not sure how much video we can actually put in this video. I've already done it twice, and the YouTube was not allowing me to put the video clips in. So I'm gonna continue the talk now as though we're all watching these videos together. And if it doesn't work, what I'll do is I'll put a link to the video that you should look at instead of if I can't show it, I'll just cut it out. But for now, we'll just watch this as though it's okay. And you know, if this is turned into a course someday, then we would be able to watch the videos together. Okay, so let's look at the anticipation stage specifically with respect to rags to riches. Their hero is overlooked and neglected. That's the basic job, the basic need that to the thing that you need to establish right in the beginning. If you're writing the David Copperfield type novel, or if you're making an Aladdin type film, right? Joseph is favored by the father, but the brothers are jealous, right? Cinderella, she's favored. She has the grace and dignity, but she's got the stepsisters, right? In Aladdin's case, he is a street rat. So let's take a look at that. Okay, you're a street rat. You were born a street rat. You'll die a street rat. Now, one thing that you'll notice with these protagonists in the beginning, specifically, especially in Disney movies, but also in the story of Joseph, there will be probably somebody lower down even than our protagonist. You know, you've got the little monkey here. You've got Benjamin. In the Joseph's younger brother in the Genesis story. In Cinderella, at least the Disney version, she's got the mice. You're going to notice that there that right away the compassion, there's naivete. Aladdin's got some street smarts, you know. He knows how to steal bread, etc. But he's also has this concern, this compassion, this vision that these other figures that are exploiting him in the beginning, like this guard here, don't have. Okay, so keep that in mind. Okay, now in Cinderella. It's the same thing. Take a look here. So you get the idea. There's a sense that these figures do not care about those underneath them. Now, this is true in real life. I think this is exactly right. Over the years, I've worked in the film business, which is a very hierarchical system, right? And I've encountered these people over the years, let's say a director, who anyone above them in the hierarchy, a money person, a producer, etc. They're the nicest people in the world. They're super charming. They're just great. And then anyone below them, they're cussing them out. They are treating them like dirt. And you can make it that way. Like you can go up the hierarchy as long as the people above you, as long as you're delivering what the people above you want, you can mistreat people down below, right? But I think that this story is saying that that's only part of the picture. What does that mean? It's only part of the picture. Booker talks a lot about this idea that story starts out with people that have fragmented views of the world and wind up with a vision of wholeness at the end. And there's various ways that stories can do that, but keep that in mind. The idea that maybe these hypothetical directors that I've worked with, maybe that policy of mistreating those below you does not work in the long run. Now you might think, well, it does work in the long run if you want to be cynical about it. But I don't know. I mean, this is one of the oldest stories in the world, and it is saying, essentially, I think it's saying that it doesn't, that you will not survive if you operate that way. And this is a lesson that our young protagonist needs to learn. Now, what you'll find is they will be tempted at some point. Once they're up there at the top, they're going to be tempted to go the same way as these protagonists, as these antagonists, right? These exploitative characters. There's going to be a moment where the hero will say, you know what? I'm going to do that too. I'm going to think about myself and forget about the people below me. And only once they pass that test, you might say, are they worthy of ruling, right? Okay, so here's another Disney movie, Ratatouille, which I absolutely love. I initially did this talk and I showed a bunch of clips from Ratatouille and it was beautiful. But Disney is not going to let me show even a single frame of Ratatouille. I found out that that algorithm on YouTube is very sharp when it comes to Disney movies. Okay, but if you remember the movie, if you want to go back and watch it, watch it after this talk, whatever, you'll notice Patton Oswalt plays the little rat who loves to cook, and he's in Paris. And his father, this is his father, right? He's his actual legitimate father. He's not a stepfather, but he's lowbrow. He eats rotten food, and Patton Oswalt has this desire to look up, just like Cinderella wants to have the nice dresses and dance with the prince, right? Patton Oswalt wants to have fine food. And then here's his brother. He doesn't know the difference between a souffle and a rotten piece of food that fell on the street, right? He's very, very base. Now, this is something that I think is important to remember, is that you're going to find levels of being in this story. You're going to have the lower levels, which are these, the animalistic levels, the urges, the biological, the stomach as opposed to the head, right? The stomach as opposed to the head. And they will rule in the beginning. And that's the same idea, like of your within your own body, right? Your stomach, when your stomach rules, that's like this. That's like a system that says it doesn't matter. Sophistication doesn't matter. Aesthetics don't matter. Beauty doesn't matter. It's just pure hunger, right? So you're gonna notice this idea that the protagonist needs to rise above that base level. Okay, in Ratatouille, you really have two protagonists, two rags to riches protagonists. One is the rat character, played by Patton Oswalt, and then this is Linguini, the young, naive, ambitious sous chef, and he is being tyrannized by this chef here, played by Ian Horn, Skinner, and Skinner becomes now the tyrannical oppressor, the step father in a sense. He's not the real father. Gusteau was the founder of the restaurant, is now gone, and now you've got this interim figure. It's kind of the Prince John to King Richard in Robin Hood idea, right? Where you have basically someone in charge who really shouldn't be in charge. Someone who's doing it wrong, doing it badly. They're there to point to an example of how not to do things. Okay, and so your protagonists are going to be exploited by these figures. And then we enter into the dream stage, and the dream stage is the fairy godmother moment, the genie moment. Magic from above, or you might say magic from the past, propels the hero up this hierarchy of success. We know in Aladdin and Cinderella, it's the fairy godmother. So this idea of the best of the past, maybe the best of your ancestors, the wisdom of your ancestors, coming in to give you advice, to give you mentorship and help. Now, in Ratatouille, it's Gusteau. It's the old chef. Now, have you noticed how they're all kind of pudgy? Very interesting. They're not hard. Usually the antagonists are hard-edged. You know, they've got this kind of porcupine effect. You know, they're streetwise, they're cunning, right? But this is all soft. They are soft and pudgy, and how else might you say it? They're not hard-edged. They're not cunning. They might have wisdom about what is good in the world, but but they're dead. And you'll notice, and I mean that literally. You'll notice with Gusteau's character here, you learn later on in Ratatouille that he died because of a bad review from the antagonist, the critic that we're going to meet later in the film. The loss of the Michelin star in his restaurant is what killed him, is what they say. So somehow the past, the wisdom from the past, isn't enough anymore to maintain peace and order in the present. They have that wisdom, but they need whatever it is that the protagonist is going to learn in order for that tradition to survive. Okay. So this leads, of course, the magic in the dream stage propels them up to the top. And then you have the dancing at the top of the world scene, which is always it's a little bit comical sometimes because there's always that facade, right? They didn't get there legitimately. And so, in other words, they don't know all the ins and outs of high society yet. The real naive them is behind a mask, behind the dress that was given to her by the fairy godmother, behind the trappings and the facade of all of the things that the genie has given to Aladdin. And in Eliza Doolittle's case, she only knows how to say a few words in the proper English. And so let's take a look at that scene with Eliza Doolittle for a really well done, I think, dancing on top of the world scene.
Months, I could pass her off as a duchess at an embassy ball. I could even get her a job as a lady's maid or a shop assistant, which requires better English.
Your name, please. Your name, miss. My name is of no concern to you whatsoever.
One moment, please.
Mrs.
Beale.
There's a young woman who wants to see you, sir.
A young woman? What does she want?
Well, she's quite a common girl, sir. Very common indeed. I should have sent her away, only I thought perhaps you wanted her to talk into your machine.
Has she an interesting accent?
Simply ghastly, Mr. Higgins.
Good. Let's have her in. Show her in, Mrs. Pierce.
Very well, sir. Speak.
What do you want, my girl?
I want to be a lady in a flower shop, instead of sitting at the corner of Tottenham Court Road. But they won't take me unless I can talk more genteel. He said he could teach me. Well, here I am, ready to pay him, not asking any favour, and he treats me as if I was dirt.
She's so deliciously low, so horribly dirty.
I ain't dirty. I wash my face and hands before I come, I did.
I'll take it. I'll make a duchess of this draggle-tailed gutter-snipe.
How?
We'll start today, now, this moment. Take her away, Mrs. Pearson, clean her. Sandpaper, if you won't come off any other way. Is it a good fire in the kitchen?
Yes, but
take all her clothes off and burn them and ring up and order some new ones. Just wrap her in brown paper till they come.
You're no gentleman, you're not to talk of such things. I'm a good girl, I am, and I know what the likes of you are, I do.
We want none of your slum prudery here, young woman. You've got to learn to behave like a duchess. Now take her away, Mrs. Pearson. If she gives you any trouble, wallop her.
Colonel Pickering, you're just in time for tea.
Thank you, Mrs. Higgins. May I introduce Miss Eliza Doolittle?
My dear Miss Doolittle.
How kind of you to let me come.
Delighted, my dear. Lady Boxington.
How do you do? How do you do?
Lord Boxington.
How do you do?
How do you do?
Mrs. Eynsford Hill, Miss Doolittle.
How do you do?
How do you do?
And Freddie Eynsford Hill.
How do you do?
How do you do?
Miss Doolittle.
Good afternoon, Professor Higgins.
The first race was very exciting, Miss Doolittle. I'm so sorry that you missed it.
Will it rain, do you think?
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain. But in Hartford, Hereford, and Hampshire, hurricanes hardly ever happen.
How awfully funny.
What is wrong with that, young man? I bet I got it right.
Smashing.
Hasn't it suddenly turned chilly?
I do hope we won't have any unseasonable cold spells. They bring on so much influenza, and the whole of our family is susceptible to it.
My aunt died of influenza, so they said. But it's my belief they'd done the old woman in.
Done her in?
Yes, Lord love you. Why should she die of influenza when she come through diphtheria right enough the year before? Fairly blue with it she was. They all thought she was dead, but my father, he kept ladling gin down her throat.
Oh.
Then she come to so sudden, she bit the bowl off the spoon.
Dear me.
Now what call would a woman with that strength in her have to die of influenza? And what become of her new straw hat that should have come to me? Somebody pinched it. And what I say is, them as pinched it, done her in.
Done her in. Done her in, did you say?
Whatever does it mean?
Oh, well, that's the new small talk. To do somebody in means to kill them.
But you surely don't believe your aunt was killed.
Do I not? Them she lived with would have killed her for a hat pin, let alone a hat.
But it can't have been right for your father to pour spirits down her throat like that. It might have killed her.
Not her. Gin was mother's milk to her. Besides, he poured so much down his own throat, he knew the good of it.
Do you mean that he drank?
Drank, my word, something chronic. Yeah. What are you sniggering at?
It's the new small talk. You do it so awfully well.
Well, if I was doing it proper, what was you sniggering at? Have I said anything I oughtn't?
Oh, no.
Not at all, my dear.
Well, that's a mercy anyhow.
I don't know whether there's... So Eliza Doolittle knows how to properly pronounce things enough to charm the prince figure in that story, right? Has she said anything she oughtn't? So this is, of course, the humor of this scene and why I love the dancing on top of the world scene. But immediately following that, the magic runs out. Why does the magic run out? Well, like we've been saying, it's not Eliza Doolittle's accomplishment. It is, because she worked hard about it, but she doesn't know anything except for the straightforward formula. There's a sense that the mentor character, the Henry Higgins, the fairy godmother, the genie, giving you advice from the past, they cannot account for the unexpected in the future. They can give you how they accomplish something. I just remember this conversation I remember having with my grandfather years ago, and he was talking about farming, and he was talking about how he could teach me everything to know about farming that he knows. And he can say, in this situation, do this, in this situation, do that. But he cannot teach me what to do when something unexpected comes up. So I think that's part of it. The knowledge that the magic, that represents maybe that knowledge, or represents probably a few other things too. But whatever it is that they've gotten, that's gotten them up to the top, is only a practice run, or it's only applicable to the specific things that it is designed to address. It's not adaptable. And so eventually that clock is going to strike midnight. Eventually that magic is going to run out. I love to use the baseball metaphor, the curveball, right? What's the curveball? Well, the curveball is when you know how to hit, you learn how to hit with your natural talent, you hit the fastball, but then they start throwing you curveballs. And when you start seeing the curveballs, you have to adjust. And that's what this magic running out, I think. It's that process of the curveball coming, and now you've got to adjust. And as well as we said, the awareness of the antagonists. Now that you've had success, they're gonna take note, and they're not gonna stand for it. So the magic runs out, and it gets the attention of the antagonists, and then they fall. They fall all the way back down to the bottom. Little Iago the bird steals the lamp, right? Let's take a look at how that happens with Eliza Doolittle.
Come on, come on, Dover. Come on, come on, Dover. Come on. Come on, Dover. Move your blooming arse.
Hear what I heard.
Don't upset yourself.
Oh, my. Come on, Dover. So Eliza Doolittle slips back into her old Cockney accent, the instincts that were being repressed in order to achieve that refinement come back. That's kind of a theme here. Remember we talked about the lower being the instinctual, hunger, instinct, the animalistic, animality, the sort of the lower things. That comes up. They have not been able to divorce themselves. Eliza has not been able to divorce herself from that cockney, a street person. Aladdin hasn't been able to pull off being a prince. Cinderella has not been able to pull off being a princess. They are still are what they are underneath. But as we'll find out, that's actually a good thing, because one of the problems with the antagonists is that they have completely divorced themselves from the body, you might say, from instinct, from the lower. And as a result, they've become tyrannical. Okay, so we'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But that's the general idea, the fall, the magic runs out. And now we get to the nightmare stage. Now, so there's a twofold process here. So first of all, the magic ran out because maybe it's because the advice from the past, the advice from the mentor just runs out. It was only given for certain scenarios, and now it has exhausted those scenarios. It might be that. It might be the existence of the curveball, the fact that now there's something new, something different to have to deal with, and you haven't learned how to do that yet. But whatever it is, the fall happens, and simultaneously, the attention of the antagonist has been piqued. And they now focus their full attention on to the protagonist, and usually they get exiled, banished from the kingdom, imprisoned, basically all the way down at the bottom, lower than they were when they started. They're lower in the sense that oftentimes they're physically lower, as we'll see in Hudsucker Proxy. Or in, Parasite, the Korean film Parasite, you'll see they wind up physically lower than they ever were. But they're lower in the sense of also their hopes and dreams, right? Because once you've been to the top and then your hopes have been dashed and you wind up down at the bottom, it's much worse. You don't have that naivete anymore. And the naivete propelled you along in a lot of ways. So there needs to be now a hardening. Remember how I talked about how all the fairy godmother, the old ghost of Gusto, the genie, etc., and you'll see also in Hudsucker Proxy, how the old guard is pudgy and soft. Now is the time when the antagonist needs to clothe themselves in some of that hardness, some of the hardness that they've encountered with the antagonist, and use that to go up to the top without losing their compassion. That's really the purpose, or the what needs to happen, you might say, in the nightmare stage, where they're now having to encounter this hard edge of the antagonist, encounter real malevolence, encounter real bullies, and so you have to shed the naivete. And the real trick here is to shed that naivete without losing your compassion. That was not possible for the antagonists in most of these stories, but it has to be possible for the protagonist in order for them to be able to be worthy of ruling the kingdom. Okay, so this is a classic scene in Aladdin where Jafar now has the lamp. Jafar has him at his mercy. This is the classic hero at the mercy of the villain scene. So usually what you find is that the ambition for power, disconnected from that which is below, disconnected from everybody that I've been saying that the protagonist has been concerned with, the lower people on the hierarchy, etc., will eventually reach a point where that antagonist goes too far. And this is the blind spot. It's Icarus flying too close to the sun, and then the wings finally melt. This case, in Aladdin, Jafar's case, he wants to go all the way to being a genie, but there is some principle in the world, some reality in the world that says too much power becomes handcuffs. Too much power, and that power now starts to control you. It's kind of the old adage, more money, more problems. Too much money, and that money, you are now going to be a slave to the money. The money is not going to work for you. You're going to be working for it. I think it's the same thing with power. Too much power, and now all of a sudden you become a slave to that power. So that's the blind spot that Aladdin learns along the way. And that's why he's able to exploit that in order to defeat Jafar. So once they defeat the antagonist, basically everyone recognizes now that the true worth, the potential, the diamond in the rough status, the overlooked status of that initial protagonist at the beginning is now recognized by all, recognized by the other half, recognized by Jasmine. Now, it's interesting, Jasmine, once she found out that he wasn't a real prince, she saw him as a fraud, right? And the first time he went to the top. But now she's seen him come to the top and she realizes that he's the real deal. He's worthy of being the Sultan. And that's the same thing with Cinderella. The shoe fits. And it's interesting that Cinderella has the shoe even after everything else disappeared, the horses, the carriage, the dress, everything else, but she still has one of the glass slippers. What does that represent? The piece of wisdom, the pearl of wisdom, you might say, that came from the fairy godmother, the insight that Aladdin got from the genie, and we're going to see what it is in Hudsucker Proxy in a minute, is retained, even though there was that fall. And then that is the thing, that is the jewel, that is the insight that propels them up to the top, that shows everybody else that they're worthy. Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit more about what that slipper really represents. Here's the slipper scene in Cinderella. So Cinderella has the other slipper. The stepmother tried to destroy the instrument used to determine worth. Interesting. But Cinderella has it, right? So the protagonist somehow learns what true worth is along the way. Okay, so we can start to see now, we can start to take these characters, these types, these archetypes, and start to plot them out on the mountain here, you might say. You know, so down here, you've got your characters that are going to rise to the top, your characters with potential. And then you've got your tradition. So you've got the new down here, you've got your old tradition over here. This old tradition is lacking something, and that old tradition is being exploited by these characters over here. Hold on. Let me get rid of myself again. The older tradition is exploited by these characters over here. All right. So so it's kind of the case that there's a blind spot that these characters have that this character will find the piece, the rags to riches character will find the piece of. But also the old tradition, in order for that to be passed on and survived, needs to get their wisdom to these protagonists down here. And then down here you have your counter examples. You've got your the little chef, the exploitative chef that was being tyrannical against Luigi, and you've got the family members, the step sisters. There are characters here that that represent those that did not make it up this ladder of being, you might say. Okay, so I want to talk a little bit about these characters here, a little bit more. Specifically, the old French critic, Anton Ego in Ratatouille. Very, very interesting. Anton Ego here, think of him as opposed to Chef Gusteau over here. Chef Gusteau has a very big body. Gusteau, like I said, he's kind of soft, but Ego here, he's skinny. He's wasted away. And there's a scene in the movie where he says, you know, I love food so much, I don't swallow if I don't like the food. That's why he's so skinny, right? He's been disconnected from the purpose of food, which is sustenance, right? Now, there might be a sense that Gusteau was overemphasizing the lower principle represented by Patton Oswalt's brother, Rat, here, and his father, right? Gusteau had the high and the low principle, but maybe he allowed that to pull him down. And so he is opposed now to Anton Ego. Very interesting name, right? Ego, the Freudian part of the brain that is the regulator, right? The in the superego, you might say, the superego is the instincts. That's more represented by these rats, by the instincts, by the animality that you see in the movie. And then ego is the mind. He's a critic, he's a writer. He's writing about food, but he's disconnected from it. And what you'll find as we go through this is that more often than not, very, very often in stories, the human task is to take the mind down and raise the earth up. And I know that might sound a little confusing right now, but hopefully it will become clear as we go along. Okay, so hopefully that was a good enough explanation, a good enough overview of the rags to riches type, the rags to riches archetype, enough for now anyway for you. And I want to now look at a 1994 movie, The Hudsucker Proxy, a great Coen Brothers movie with Tim Robbins and Paul Newman. And you'll notice that the up and down, the imagery of the high and the low, is very prominent in this. And they play with it in such a brilliant way, the metaphors and the symbols that they use. It's absolutely perfect. So you start off with Norval Barnes, who is, like everybody else, neglected and overlooked. In this case, he's not a child, but he has that childlike naivete, the childlike enthusiasm, right? And that's contrasted with the antagonist, which is Paul Newman's character of Sidney J. Musburger. And he's all the way at the top. And in fact, they keep using this tower, the up, the down, the up, the down, right? And then there's this tragic figure, which is going to come back later in the film. Charles Durning is wearing Hudsucker. Now, I'll spoil it for you a little bit. Wearing Hudsucker is the fairy godmother. Wearing Hudsucker is the genie. Wearing Hudsucker is the mentor character. The wisdom from the past that this antagonist is not passing on correctly is given to Norval Barnes. Okay, so let's take a look at the opening scene. I want you to look at this circle here and remember that because that's important. Okay, so we see Norval Barnes here, down in the mailroom, down at the very, very bottom, just like we saw in Ratatouille, just like we saw with Aladdin, just like we saw with Cinderella. And he receives something, just like with Aladdin, called a blue letter. And the blue letter is going to be the thing that causes him to go all the way up to the top.
I got big ideas.
I'm sure you do.
For instance, take a look at this sweet baby. I developed it myself. Yes, sirree, this is my ticket upstairs.
So, Norval Barnes, working in the mailroom, says that he's got this circle. And he says, yes, sirree, this is my ticket upstairs. So maybe you might say, and this is the argument I'm going to try to convince you of, that is what the world needs. The world needs that circle. The world is lacking that circle in some sense. Norval Barnes has it, but nobody appreciates it for what it is, right? The other employees in the company, they don't understand it. This is the diamond in the rough. This is the new idea. This is the new that needs to be recognized in order for the community, in order for the company, you might say, to survive. So he's got the diamond in the rough status, just like Aladdin, just like Cinderella. And now he needs the genie moment, the genie moment. He needs to be propelled all the way up. So what happens? He's given a blue letter. The blue letter, I'm going to try to make a case to you, is the glass slipper in this story. The blue letter is what is given to him by the genie figure, by the mentor figure, by the fairy godmother figure. And you won't notice that until the end. That's the way that the Coen brothers decided to reveal it, but that's essentially what happened. So he's given the blue letter, and he goes all the way up the elevator to the top. And then you also have the scene here where he's nice to the elevator operator, Buddy, just like Aladdin is nice to the monkey, and Linguini is nice to the rat. There's this sense that he's got that compassion for those underneath him. Okay, and he's got this circle, and he's going all the way up to the top of the company to talk to Musburger, who is the antagonist.
It better be good. I'm in a bad mood.
Well, sir, I've got something for you from the mailroom, but first, if I could just take a minute or two of your very valuable time to show you a little something I've been working on for the past 2 or 3 years. You know, for kids. Which is perfect for Hudsucker. Not that I claim to be any great genius. Like they say, inspiration is 99% perspiration, and in my case, it's at least twice that. But I gotta tell you, sir, this sweet baby...
Wait a minute!
So, Norval Barnes is sent up to the very, very top with this blue letter, and he pitches the circle, right? And then he's chosen to be the patsy by Paul Newman, by Sidney J. Musburger. But what the Coen brothers, I think, are setting up here is this idea that there is a contrast between this, the Tower of Babel, the vertical, and this, the circle. So you might say that what the world has is this top-down, tyrannical, bureaucratic, wasteful. All of these early scenes are showing just how wasteful this bureaucracy is, how jaded everybody is within that bureaucracy, and how Norval Barnes is not jaded and does want it to make it work. It's a Mr. Smith Goes to Washington story. And he's got this circle, and the circle represents everything that this is missing and everything that Musburger is missing. So that leads us then to the dancing with royalty, dancing on top. Musburger chooses him to be the head of the company. However, it's the dream stage, right? It's not real. He's the patsy. They're using him as the one to pin the downfall of the company on him while they profit off of the stock, while the board profits off of the stock. And the other thing that happens during this period where he's at the top, he gets the attention of the usurpers, of people, the newspaper reporter and the eventual love interest, who look at him at the top and they say, we want to bring him down. So there's always that aspect of the character is somehow artificially propped up and artificially taken all the way to the top, but they don't have the skills to sustain it. They still have the naivete. They don't have the shrewdness, right? So during this dream stage, he's at the top, he's dancing. You notice there's some other thing that happens during this phase. The attention of the prince is captured by Cinderella. That's legitimate. That is from her pure potential. That is not from the dress. It is not from the coach. You know, all the things that the fairy godmother gave to Cinderella, the thing that really impresses the prince is not all those trappings. Same thing with Aladdin, right? All of the stuff that the genie gives him to impress Princess Jasmine, right? She finds something within him underneath all of those artificial layers that is of true worth. And what happens in Hudsucker Proxy? Well, It's this circle. He actually, even though he's artificially propped up to the top, he finds a way to implement his circle idea. And then you get that great scene with the hula hoop.
What if you tie before it's done?
Does it have rules?
Can more than one play?
What makes you think it's a game?
Is it a game?
Will it break?
It better break eventually.
Is there an object?
What if you tie before it's done?
Does it come with batteries?
Could we charge extra for them?
Is it safe for toddlers?
How do you know when you finish?
So it turns out that this idea, the circle, what the world needs, in the face of this bureaucratic, beautiful bureaucratic world that the Coen brothers set up so beautifully. Even in the scene where he's pitching the hula hoop, all of the board members are asking questions. How can we exploit people? How can we exploit people? Can we charge for batteries? Just a million questions on every single one of them, another way to exploit people, right? And Norval Barnes here, the Mr. Smith goes to Washington, the purity, the naivete of this idea. It is what the world needs, but there's all of these forces of antagonism now that are going to set themselves up against Norval Barnes to make it so that that can't succeed. Now, what you have in the dream stage is that initial scene of success where you see the kid playing with the hula hoop and it thwarts the plan of Musburger. And now, of course, they've got it in for him and they want him to fail. However, the moment when he does fall, the moment when he falls is actually when Buddy here, Buddy comes and pitches a circle to him. Remember, he pitches the straw to him. And what does Norval Barnes do? He rejects it. He's going the way of Musburger here. And that rejection of the circle, remember, because in this story, what the world needs is the circle. Anytime the circle is introduced, things work. Anytime the vertical top-down hierarchy is introduced, things fall apart. And what happens to Norval Barnes? He's exploited for that. The newspaper comes out that he was a fake, that he stole the idea, that the circle idea wasn't really his. It was Buddy's the whole time. And you even got this scene where Buddy is sitting here on the ground begging him, and Norval Barnes is up top looking down. He's completely switched places from where he was before. And that's what that's the weakness. That's the chink in his armor that gives Musburger the chance to exploit him. And the newspaper article comes out that he's a fake. And even this scene, I love this scene with the psychologist. It has a graph showing where the patient is going. And he winds up in this underground bar, all the way down at the bottom, drunk and alone and even lower than where he was. Now he's jaded because before he had all that optimism, now he doesn't have all that optimism, right? And we're set up now for our journey back up to the top. So the journey back up to the top, how does that happen in this? He winds up jumping off the building, just like Waring Hudsucker did. So you can sort of see the journey up. Remember, he gets the blue letter. And what did I say the blue letter was? The slipper. He uses the circle. That's the missing piece that the world needs. He gets all the way to the top in the dream stage. In the frustration stage, he's knocked down a peg. And then in the nightmare stage, he's completely full of despair, and he's completely exploited by the antagonist. And what happens in the depths of despair, who shows up but the fairy godmother or the old chef or basically the wisdom from the past brandishing this circle? And what does he tell him? Charles Durden here, Waring Hudsucker, the old dead. Remember, these mentors are always dead in this plot type. Tells him, look in your pocket, you've got the blue letter. It's kind of the same thing as saying, discovering, oh, I've still got the slipper. I've still got it, right? And what does it say? It basically says, whoever you choose to succeed you in the company must be what? Worthy. Must be worthy of it. And so therefore, all of the stock goes to that person. So this blue letter now shows the world that the wisdom of the past has chosen him to be the one that succeeds. Okay, so now we can plot this out. I'm going to hide myself here for a second so you can see the whole thing. So you can kind of plot this out with the two mountain idea, right? So you've got your lower, your naive protagonist. He gets this piece of magic. In this case, it's the blue letter that sends him up to the top. It comes from the fairy godmother, the fairy godfather, etc. He's got this diamond in the rough status, which is the circle. And then he goes to the top, but betrays that circle. when he says no to Buddy, he winds all the way back down at the bottom. But then he discovers what he's learned along the way, which is in this blue letter. And then what happens in the very end? He's pitching the circle again. Once he's head of the company, he's pitching the circle again, and he's inventing the frisbee. And again, the mentor, the anima character, the other half, she recognizes what he has. She understands. And if you watch her journey the whole way through, she goes on a journey where she's at first trying to be like Musburger. She's trying to climb up the ladder using exploitation, but in meeting Norval Barnes, she realizes that you need ambition and compassion, and she recognizes it, just like Jasmine recognized it in Aladdin, just like the prince recognized it in Cinderella. And then we have our antagonist who winds up down at the bottom. So it's kind of funny. I mean, this movie, Coen Brothers movies, famously, the Coen Brothers movies are confusing for people. There's a lot of symbols in them. And they're so well done. The details are so well done. You can miss the big picture sometimes, but this is almost a perfect picture of the rags to riches story. and so it really shows, I think that you could, take one of the seven plots. You could try this as an exercise, take one of the seven plots, plot it out like I'm talking about, in terms of this shape. I really think these stories have graphic, where's my mouse? Okay. Plot it out in terms of this shape. I really think that these stories have this central metaphor of the up and the down, the up and the down, the peaks and the valleys. If you understand that, you can draw on all of this history. There are people who have thought about what exactly this figure from the past is, the fairy godmother figure. They have thought about what the diamond in the rough status is that the protagonist needs. They have thought about why the other half recognizes the worth and value in the protagonist. They have thought about what it is that makes the antagonist, that makes the Jafars of the world fall. They have thought about what this slipper, what this blue letter represents. I mean, I just think it's fascinating. Okay, so this is, again, something that I'm working out for myself. And there's a sense that I'm working it out loud. I'm using the excuse of making a video to force myself to research these things a little bit closer. And every time I do, every time I do a dry run on a video and don't release it, hopefully this is the one that I do release, I learn a little bit more, and I learn a little bit more, and I learn a little bit more. So I'm having a lot of fun with it. So that was Rags to Riches, right? I hope that you can see that there was a lot going into that. There is a lot that goes into these Rags to Riches stories. And next, we'll take a look at Overcoming the Monster. I've already done a lot of work on Overcoming the Monster, and I'm really excited about it. And please let me know in the comments what you think, and I will talk to you next time.